back with my partner, Bobby Kennedy. Hey, you know, it's been weeks now. I've been gone. You've been gone. David Bender's covered for us. Sam Cedar's covered for us. And we've tried to put together shows that haven't lost their quality at all. But welcome back, my friend. Welcome
back.
Thank
you, Mike. And same to you.
Yeah, it seems, this last week has been an emotional turmoil for you. Actually, several weeks with your loss of Eunice as well. What is your thought about how everything was handled? I mean, what is your thought about?
Well, you know, it was a very sad time for my family, for me. Teddy was my godfather. Eunice was my godmother. I had close relationships with both of them. Both of them were, you know, Teddy was a surrogate father to me and to my 10 brothers and sisters since the death of my father in 1968. He performed that function for 29 grandchildren, or 29 grandchildren of Joseph Kennedy, who essentially grew up without fathers. And he was, you know, he was extraordinarily attentive to all of us. He never missed a birthday. He called me every birthday. He sent me a present every birthday since I was born. Every Christmas, he called our spouses on their birthdays. He called us on our anniversaries. I called him. I spoke to him almost weekly, and he always returned my phone calls religiously and without any exception within 20 minutes. Not always personally, but I would get a call from his secretary saying, Teddy's on the floor and he's going to call you at 3:30 this afternoon or something like that. But usually he called personally. So, and then to hear, you know, I went out. There were 100,000 people lining the road from Hyannisport when we brought him up to Boston for the viewing at the Kennedy Library. And I went out, there were 25,000 people in line to get into the library. I went out to shake hands with them and just heard one after the other with my children, which was wonderful. Because they heard these stories, you know, of people saying, oh, he helped me get into the VA, he helped me get my veterans benefits, he helped me get my Social Security, he found me housing, and just so many personal stories, or you know, people at immigration, a Costa Rican guy who had his son killed in Iraq, and had then Teddy had helped him get his U.S. citizenship, the father get his U.S. citizenship, but on and on and on, there was so many people, and then he was concerned, of course, about the overarching issues that, you know, that really define us as Americans. That
if I were to try to distill what is so obvious and sometimes it's missed, he is almost the last of the New Deal liberals that really cared about people, that care about the same issues you and I talk about on the show all the time.
That's right. I mean, he wanted America to be an exemplary nation. Even in this last year, this last summer, he came out and we played with 60 great-grandchildren on the lawn every night, capture the flag, and he would come out and play with them. And his concern was always that the little kids be included. And that's, you know, he saw the United States as a big family, and you know, that we had to go forward as a family, and we had to include the people who may not be as competitive on, you know, or up to some of the greatest challenges, but we had to avoid the seduction of the notion that we could advance ourselves as a people by leaving our poor brothers and sisters behind. We had to be an exemplary nation. We had to be examples of justice, of democracy. We had to look at the Constitution and say, you know, and avoid the arguments that it was a luxury that we could no longer afford. It was the soul of our country. And
One thing that I've always remembered about I read something just years ago where he was so impressed with Hubert Humphrey's notion that we judge our nation and our culture and our government according to how we treat our children, our elderly, how we treat the least of our society. And it was almost like, I mean, he was really moved by that in the article that I read. I mean, it was genuinely something that he said he tried to grasp hold of and live out in his life as a politician. I think he was pretty successful with that, don't you? I mean,
he touched
everybody's life.
He was, some of the eulogies were right, but he was, you know, that he really, in the Senate, Joe Biden said to this to me afterwards, and a couple of other, and Bob Casey from Pennsylvania said, echoed Joe Biden. He said, he, you know, it wasn't that he had charm that made him, you know, such a good legislator and that people just liked him, but he made people want to be better than they were. He made people, you know, he made people, inspire them to transcend their narrow self-interest or their short-term political interest and act on behalf of the entire community. And part of that was his passion for, you know, he had the gift of empathy. He had in his own family three critically ill children. Cara, who had lung cancer that was diagnosed as terminal, and she survived because of health care. Teddy, who at 11 years old lost his leg to cancer. And then Patrick, who had chronic asthma. And, you know, he wondered, well, what happens to people who don't have the resources that I have? You know, what do they do? He had lost a brother. He lost three of his brothers to violence, but one during World War II. And so when they, you know, when there were people in the state, every single time somebody was killed in Iraq, Teddy called the family. He called the families of every single person who was who had a family member who was killed in the World Trade Center attacks. He wept when he talked about it. He had that, you know, very Irish kind of nostalgia and sentimentality. When he talked about his brother Joe privately to us, he wept. I talked to him last year about my father's assassination, and he wept. But he was also, you know, he embraced life. He had huge appetites, and some of those were defects that he was. They read an extraordinary letter at the gravesite that didn't go on TV, but it was a letter that he'd written Pope Benedict just before he died, saying that he was dying and that he had, you know, talking about his weaknesses and his failures as a human, and saying that, you know, he begged for the prayer of the Pope, and he begged for redemption. And that's really who he was. He was very emotional. He was passionate. And he was filled with laughter and song. And he was an extraordinary man who, an extraordinary father to all of us. And, you know, he was just good fun. About 10 days before he died, Mike, he was losing his ability to find words at that point, but he was still sailing every day. And he understood everything that was going on around him, but he couldn't always get the words together to, you know, to have a full conversation. It was just before he passed away. And I saw him out on his sailboat with his son, Teddy. And I had a little motorboat that I was out with a bunch of little kids, a lot of the cousins, about 10 cousins on this little whaler. And I went by them, and we were the only ones out on Nantucket Sound because there was big waves and the kids were water skiing and stuff. And we went by the Maya, which was his sailboat, and I waved to him, and he turned around with effort to look at the kids and to wave to all of us. And he paused for a second looking for something to say, and then he started yodeling. And when he was about 20 years old, he had climbed the Matterhorn, and he had learned from the Swiss to yodel, and he often would, when he sang, he had a beautiful voice, he had an Irish tenor, and he would sing all the time. That was his kind of big entertainment. And he was an amazing dancer besides, despite his bulk. But he would yodel sometimes when he sang, and it was, you know, it was something that he did. And that he, I saw him on the dock, and he was in his wheelchair. You know, they were taking him off the tender. He was not in a wheelchair. He was in a golf cart. He had walked up the steps, and they brought a golf cart out to make it easier for him. And he looked at me, and he looked me really intensively in the eye, and then he grabbed me, and he said, and he yodeled, you know, he went yodel-ay-hoo, but in his the way he could do it, which was really beautiful. And then he looked at me again, smiled, and he said, "It's all I got left, kid." But you know, he always had that. It was a sense of fun. Well, and that's something that, you know, all of us, the members of his family will miss.
You're such a great writer. I see a good book here. Let's take a quick break. I'm going to be right back with my partner who's back from vacation, Bobby Kennedy.